this is going to be an interesting talk for you, if you like playing video games especially. So I studied medicine here in GSL Medical College, after which I've moved to the UK to do my master's in healthcare administration. I came back to India after that, and I saw a lot of technology happening in medical education and how it's being trained, thanks to my father, who's also a surgeon, by the way. And then I saw, there's a lot of interesting things happening, so I should do my PhD in this. So I moved to the Netherlands to do this. So how would you think about medical training? When you think about medical training, what is the first thing that comes to you? Sorry? Oh, cadavers, right? You see that here. It's all virtual. So it's a replacement for that. But when I think about how I went into this journey, I thought it must have been due to the fact I was obsessed with video games. I'm sure most of you must share the same passion with me here. What kind of video games do you play nowadays? I mean, I used to play on my iPhone, it's Angry Birds. What do you play? I heard it's very violent, obviously, today. But, there's a lot of war games as well, like Call of Duty on your PS4, or Xbox these days. But how often do you play real games in the field? Cricket, badminton, or tennis? Okay, but let's be honest. Do you play those games more often, or do you play the games on your devices? Right? So what's the fundamental difference between these two forms of gaming? One is real, one is virtual. But there's something more interesting, trust me. So let's take a step back. So you're already kids, but I'm talking about medical students. When we were kids, we had to go to this torturous routine of physical training with our physical education teachers and coaches. Who taught you how to play your first game, like cricket? It has a lot of set of rules, but who taught you how to play the game? Huh? Your coach, right? Or your friends? Right? Someone had to teach you how to play the game. Is it true? But when you had to play the game on your devices, what did you do? You just had to download the game, right, from the App Store, like you do these days? Or you had to go to the market and buy a disc and download it, right? And then you had a set of easy on-screen instructions, like a menu, player mode difficulty, and then you can play the game all by yourself. So when you think about it, you taught yourself the game. Would you agree to that? So what has this got to do with medical training, you might ask me? So when you're playing the games in the field with your friends, how did you know you're doing better than them? You had scores, right, to keep track of? They tell you you're doing better than your friends. And in the field, you know that you're doing great. But do the scores tell you you're actually the best? The best in the broader sense of the word, the world even? Or do the scores tell you, hey, you threw the ball with this much velocity, or it hit the bat at this exact spot? Or, it's the exact joint mobility it takes to hit the ball out of the park. You don't get all this information, right? Unless you're Sachin Tendulkar or Roger Federer, who have millions of dollars and coaches to track every moment of it. But when you play the games on your devices, at the end of each game, what do you see? You see a list of data, entire range of statistics for you to deal with. So say if you're playing a war game like Call of Duty, at the end of the game, what do you usually see? You see how many war criminals you've killed, or how many headshots you got, or even how many people you missed killing, right? So you use all this data to make yourself a better player for the next time. Is it true? And you even get the chance to compete with the best players in the world with that single game, right? But when you play cricket on the field, do you think you can compete against Sachin Tendulkar? So do you see the difference between video games and, real games? So, two things to take from this. One, there is immense technology happening around us, especially in medicine nowadays. There's robotics, you know, there's different ways of treating cancer, curing diseases. There's immense number of treatment protocols, right? But as medical students, if we think about it, how is it affecting our day-to-day lives, you know? Is it affecting us in our decade-long career, decade-long studies? Probably not. So when you think about it, the most important job on the planet, saving lives, should have the same training tools when it comes to teaching, right? But the sad truth is, me and you probably and are learning from the same books and the same curriculum our parents and teachers have followed. So now imagine if you're a surgeon, right? You just got a seat in the surgery by after passing the NEET examination. So you have to follow your surgeon teacher into the operation theater. You know, you have to assist him for, say, 1,000 procedures before you're ever given a chance to hold the instrument. But when you get the chance to do the procedure, how do you think this surgeon judges you? Do you think he judges you against the best surgeons in the world? Or does he judge him against who he is? Right? A teacher always measures a student by how good he compares himself to him, right? So here we are limited by surgeons, you know, by how good the teacher is. So this stuck to me. I mean, if we can do so much with video games these days, I mean, why not do something like that for surgeons? I mean, after all, we have videos that capture surgeries. So during my PhD in the Netherlands, that's exactly what I did. So in the software I created, so this is something like this. Please don't be grossed out. It's a real surgical procedure. And what I created was motion tracking. So, you know, just like the video games, you can track exactly how the surgeon is going to perform. And we tracked n number of surgeons. We tracked so many important surgeons in the world that we know exactly what an expert surgeon performs like. So as surgical students, you can exactly know how you measure up against the best surgeons in the world by just using the software and analyzing your videos. That way you can, you know, there's a lot of room for improvement. So before you ask me, what has this got to do with your PlayStations at your home? I mean, I'd like to show you this. What's the first thing that comes into your mind when you see this? Joysticks? Exactly, something like that, right? So this is something I'd like to call, you know, a PlayStation for surgeons. How do these devices compare to the devices you have at home? So when you play a game, what's the first thing you do? You say, oh, easy, normal, hard. You select a level, right? And you go, and oh, I want to play my game today in, say, London. I want to kill some World War II soldiers or something like that, right? But you can't do that in real life, can you? Like, you can't say, oh, my life is, you know, it's not that easy. I want to make it a bit easier. You can't choose your level. In the same way, imagine you're a surgeon and say, oh, I want to operate on that patient. You know, he has this very interesting disease happening. I want to wait until this guy comes into my doorstep and I want to perform a procedure on him. Do you think it's fair for the patient? It's not fair, right? It's very unethical even. So by using this, a surgeon can recreate any pathology or any disease and operate on any patient he likes, and he can even choose what kind of difficulty he wants to practice on. So how do we see this technology moving forward? If you think about hospitals, you know, and operation theaters or ICUs, what's the first thing that comes to mind? I would say, you know, patients moving around, staff talking to each other, you know, machines whirring, instruments buzzing, right? It's so chaotic. Now, when you think how surgeons prepare for this, they have to take exams like everyone, right? They have to sit in the examination with you all probably at one point of life. And how does an examination hall look like? It's very calm, right? So calm, you can hear your own thoughts. But do you think it's fair a surgeon is measured outside his primal environment that's an operation theater? Probably not. Have you ever heard of virtual reality goggles? Yes. So we can do exactly that with this machine. So we can create a real operation theater environment. We can create all the happenings in a surgical theater, you know, staff talking. Every little distraction that buzzes you off, and we can see how exactly a surgeon performs under this this environment. I'll show you a brief clip of that. So that's me putting on the goggles. So I can see myself in the operation theater at that point. I can select my instruments, and that's my nurse on the right, and that's my teacher. I can see the entire theater there, and there's an anesthetist sitting behind me trying to annoy me. So you can see I can perform the entire procedure seamlessly. So whenever I pick an instrument, my nurse tells, oh, you picked the right instrument, doctor. So I have a whole range of instruments, all with the use of a single instrument. Now, when I perform the procedure, whenever I make a mistake, see, I ruptured a vessel there, and there's bleeding all over the place. Now my doctor is right there to scold me. He will tell me, oh, you did it wrong, Sandeep. You need to convert it into open surgery and make, you know, you're trying to save the patient. So this is how it's going to look like. This is where we stand at, where how surgeons are trained. So how does this go forward? What are the implications of it in real life, you would ask me. So this is a 360-degree video of an operation theater we captured here in the Netherlands a few weeks ago, actually. I can't show you the video because of patient reasons. But imagine you're a surgeon or a doctor who just got a job offer in this hospital, right? Do you know that person? You don't know him. Do you know what that instrument is or how it's operated? Probably not, right? So, but by using these goggles, you can already be in that operation theater. You can know exactly how the staff talk to each other. You know where the instruments are placed or how stuff is done in the hospital. So even before you get into the hospital, you can already perform a procedure there. So by the time you get to the hospital, you're already a pro, right? So this is what we call reducing time to talent. So it improves, like, you know, staff efficiency, whoever is a surgeon or be it anesthetist or whoever it is. And it also improves patient safety and hospital efficiency. You know, everyone is to gain in this scenario. So now we talked about that. So like I said, I was going to talk about video games and surgeons. There are several characteristics that you can attribute to each medical specialty. So for example, surgeons are better at gaming. So surgeons who game better perform better because they have better reflexes, right? You know, how fast do you play a game? That makes you a better surgeon because how fast you can react to a situation. And even if you take other medical specialties, critical thinking is an important aspect. If you're a psychiatrist, empathy is an important factor of your career. And if you're an anesthetist working in a critical care unit, you need to be able to work under stress. So these are all the situations we can replicate in these scenarios. So imagine the possibility. You all want to be doctors, like you just said. So even before you want to be a doctor, you can use this technology right here in GSL and see if you're fit to be a doctor. That's all. Thank you.